Okay, so after some deliberation about the kale project, I decided that I'm going to grow both microgreens in this container here, where we can look at the root structure as it forms down there, and I'll get a little sample of that, and also baby greens. So I'm going to grow them in this tray and let them get all the way till their first set of true leaves, and then I'll be able to clip them and let them grow back for at least 3 or 4 sets of salad. Because I don't like the idea of just growing seeds just for their one chop and then they're done. So that's going to be an experiment for middle of winter microgreens, tons of seed situation. And then what I'm going to do with the baby kale is see if I can separate the root structure after a month or two when it's warm enough outside and use them as transplants to bring out. That way it's a kind of synergistic thing. You've got crops in the early spring, late winter, and then you can transplant them out and start your garden. But we have a self-propagating kale forest outside. So it's not really essential for us, but for future years and for other people who don't have that, we're going to do that. And this is the soil that I've been using. This is ProMix, and it's called Mycoactive because it's got mycorrhizal spores in it. That's a symbiotic beneficial fungi that helps the roots to take up extra water and nutrients and minerals, especially once you plant them outside. And they give a little bit of sugar and carbohydrates to the fungus. The fungus reaches places the roots can't, and the benefit is pretty amazing. I've noticed probably 150% crop yield increase. So that's the plan. One of the things I've loved about growing an open pollinated heirloom variety of kale, like Red Russian, is that if you leave it to the second year, it'll go to seed and you'll get an abundance of seed pods. This is one of the branches of seed pods coming from the plant. I've let it dry, hanging in a cool, dry place for a couple months. It didn't need to do that long, but I have. And I'm going to be showing how to separate the pods from the stalk, from the stem, and then how to separate the seeds from the individual pods so that they can either be stored, or in my case, I'm going to be planting them in a tray to make some microgreens. Okay. So the trick with these kale seed pods, for me, is that I give them a twist on both ends, and then they separate into their two halves, and the seeds kind of roll out. And then I put the husk in a different place, and I move on to the next pod. Now, I have seen people use the method of grinding all the seed pods up and separating the husks through some kind of sieve or strainer, where it's big enough for the seeds to fall through, but not the husk debris. But I'm not doing a big industrial process, and I want to have an eye on what seeds go in and what seeds don't, so I do them individually, and this works for my needs. So I separate all the seeds onto a plate, and these guys have already been drying for so long that I would be satisfied with them going right into a bag for long-term storage with a few silica beads to keep them desiccated. But usually if they were just right off the plant and they were dry husks on the plant, you would take them onto this plate after you separate them and then put them in a dry, dark place for a couple weeks so they get really dry before you bag them up. So in the other one where I'm growing baby greens, I just did a light sprinkle because I thought the seeds might need a little bit of space so that they can get their leaves out and not just be a super tight bunch. But for this microgreens experiment, I'm going to be putting quite a bit, probably like a tablespoon at least of seeds or more, so that they can have a super tight setup, and then when they're clipped there's a nice amount. So this is how I'm going to do this. And then I'll take pictures as soon as they sprout and do a slideshow so we can see a time lapse of how they grow. In here I've got about 1.5 inches of pre-dampened soil, and I didn't mention the other one is pre-dampened as well beneath, so that when I use the mister on top it doesn't disturb the soil so much and redistribute their positioning. So I think I'll go for about that much. Still got lots of seed left. I'll have to do more. I'll have to do another microgreen setup. A different container. And I'm just putting enough soil just to barely cover the seeds, so they have no resistance and they all come up evenly. Not looking to support their stems for the long haul in this case, so. And that should be good. Now I'll mist them. Just making sure it's evenly damp and not soaking wet. And I'll let them germinate. Garden Journal number 4, March 11th. Today we're going to be talking about ginger, some of the amazing benefits of ginger, and showing how to make a ginger tea, and also getting an update on where the seedlings are that I've started, how the sweet potato here is looking, which I've got started in the jar to grow slips, and it's got some nice roots growing in the water now, and foliage is about 3 inches long, the shoots, and some nice leaves starting to form. Beautiful purple color. Then they change to green as they get some chlorophyll in them from the photosynthesis. Also, be taking a look at how the experiments are doing with the kale, which is microgreens in the clear container here. They are sprouting so vigorously that they're bursting through the earth like some kind of sci-fi scene. And then the kale baby greens, which are doing amazing too. And that's only after 3 days. That's kind of germination we're getting. So I'll show the other video of how we made the ginger tea. Okay, so this is what you'll need to make our ginger lemon tea. 3 green tea bags. It's going to end up being about half of this lemon. And for people who are just starting off making it, I would suggest a piece of ginger about this size, or about the size of a thumb. Because we use lots because we like it really strong, but that's going to be a bit spicy for most people's mouths. So I'm using a little piece of the ginger we grew, as well as some store-bought ginger. And you'll need, of course, the peeler, because the store-bought ginger, if it's conventionally grown, is sprayed with growth inhibitors and probably other pesticides and preservatives, and you don't want that in your tea. So make sure to peel the ginger nice, and a nice sharp knife so we can cut it thin once we peel it. Honey and 2 liters of water in a medium-sized pot. So I'll start by peeling the ginger. I'm not even going to peel the stuff that we grew at home because I know exactly what went into the soil, and I gave it a nice rinse, and the skin is inevitably going to have good nutrients and properties in it, just like the rest of it will. Even if you were to buy organic store-bought ginger, you wouldn't necessarily know what's in the soil. They could have used, you know, say, manure as a slow-release fertilizer, so you would definitely want to skin it, even if it's organic from the store. Okay, so I got off as much as I could, then I just cut out the odd little areas. Make sure I got any brown spots off. And to start off, I throw 2 tea bags right into the water. And I'll show you that after. Then I start to cut the ginger really thin. So I cut one part so it's flat, so it'll sit on the board. And then cut it as thin as I can. The thinner you cut it, the stronger the flavor is going to be, and the more of the beneficial properties you're going to get out of the ginger. Because we're not going to bring the water to a boil. It's just going to be right below a boil at a simmer. So to draw out the good stuff, you want it nice and thin. Get out of there. And then for the lemon, you definitely want to make sure you rinse off the peel before you put it in, because they'll spray pesticides on lemon. But the great thing about lemon, even if it's conventional, if you can't afford organic like us, is the properties of the lemon peel and the oils keep out anything from the internal structure. So I cut it in half, and then I cut 3 nice rings out of it. Save the other half for something else. And then I cut off the skin, and that way, by cutting off the peel, if there was anything sprayed onto it, it's not getting on the inside where we're drinking from. Okay, so we got our 3 slices. Now I'll put them in the pot here. And make sure I separate each one so that they're not stuck together and not getting out all the good stuff. So everything goes in at this point, except for the honey and the last tea bag. And then I'll put the stove to about 6, so medium high. And I will wait until the little bubbles start to form and it's just below a boil. And then I'll throw in this tea bag and the honey, but I'll show you that in another clip. And I kept this piece so I could show a real close up of what it's like to cut it nice and thin. So the trick is position your finger so it can be the guide. And if you can get it so it's almost translucent thin, then you're gonna get some good tea. Theoretically, you could just take the peeler and just run it along the side of this thing until you carve most of the way through it. But I like having these slices of ginger floating around in the tea myself. So this is the way I do it. And then I keep the little leftover pieces in bags because if you have a tummy ache or something, you can just chew on a piece of ginger and that'll pretty much end it right away if you feel anything coming on, like a little throat cold or something. Or if you want to have a quick breath freshener, better than Listerine for your body. And by the way, I forgot to explain, I leave these two last slices of the rind about this big so that in the end I can kind of balance it out if it doesn't have enough lemoniness. When you get the water start to steam and get nice and warm, but before the actual boiling point, that's when you throw in the last bag of tea, and I put a drop of honey on each lemon, but basically it's just a drizzle of honey. And then you mix that in. And then you don't have to put tons of honey, but in the end you can use it to balance it out if it's too spicy. So, you know, wait until the end before you decide to put lots. And also, you will need a glass of kind of room temperature or cold water so that when it does reach the boiling point and you want to bring it back down to simmering temperature, you pour that in and that kind of arrests the temperature so you're not going to boil out the beneficial properties. So you'll start to hear the sound of the little bubbles forming on the bottom when the water reaches the boiling point. But I wait until there's actually visually little bubbles starting to rise up before I put in the cooling water and lower the temperature on the stove. So we'll wait for those to happen. Ah, they're starting there in the open now. Okay, I can see some bubbles actually rising up now. Okay, so now I'm going to put in the cold water and turn the dial down to just below 2. Now, it's probably different on each stove, so you might want to watch it and make sure that it's not going to come back to a boil at 2, depending on what kind of metal you're using, pot, and your size of your element, etc. But mine's at 2, it stays below a boil. Then I set the timer for about 20 minutes, but for us, we leave it in for 40 to make it extra strong. And after that, you can scoop it out and add a little bit of honey for flavor, a little bit of lemon if it needs it, and that's our ginger lemon tea. It's really amazing for its anti-inflammatory properties. So if you get home after a hard day's work and your sore muscles, if you drink some ginger tea, it really helps with the inflammation. It gets rid of the lactic acid buildup in your muscles and you won't feel the same ache the next day after a workout or a hard day's work. Also, there's new studies that have been shown that neurological disorders like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's, which have to do a lot with inflammation of the neurological tissue, that if you drink ginger tea or include ginger in your diet in a big way, it's actually going to prevent the inflammation, which leads to the cognitive dissonance. Which is associated with memory loss and motor function impairment. So ginger is amazing for that. Also, if you're starting off with a cold, ginger will zap it. It's an amazing antiviral, antibiotic, and antiseptic. And aside from that, it boosts the metabolism. So cranks up your tummy and you can lose weight faster if you're trying to do that. Aside from that, I'll show you a little clip of what's going on outside. We've got some early bloomers. The irises are already popping up. Chives, hydrangeas are starting to sprout. And I had parsley and oregano that survived the winter somehow. So they're still going. So it's March 8th, and here is a look at some of the early risers that we've got already either starting out in the garden from seed from last year or that have survived the winter. These are red Russian kale, and these guys, they planted themselves in the fall and they've survived all winter, and now they're coming back to life again. They're growing on the what was my sweet potato mound, so I'll let them get some momentum and then transplant them to a better spot. And then amongst them is arugula, which has seeded itself in the wind, I guess, from over where it was growing on the side of the fence. And apparently they like to grow together. It looks like the kale is shielding the more sensitive arugula in the colder days, and they're making good friends. Another one that's already started to seed itself and come to life is German chamomile, and there's a whole bunch of this growing around. So we're off to a good start. The lilac buds are swelling. Throw the magnolia, and looks like we'll be able to have salad soon. Next week I'll be looking at my four most successful crops to date, which were the ginger, sweet potatoes, kale, and beets. Those four crops, with the minimal investment of money, have produced prolifically. And the crop yield for square footage is by far the best, and their benefits for the body are amazing. The antioxidants of deep red beets, deep orange sweet potatoes, deep green kale, and then the ginger that I just talked about. So those are the four power crops I'll be talking about next week. And that's it. Garden Journal 4 signing out.